Now, the rice fruit diet was Dr. Kempner's attempt at creating a no salt, no cholesterol diet that's practically pure carbohydrates. And what he found was that by feeding his patients this diet, he could reverse four conditions. Number one, malignant hypertension, which was thought to be incurable at the time. Number two, heart disease. Number three, diabetic retinopathy. And number four, kidney disease. Now let's think about this for a second, because it doesn't fully make sense. Conventional diabetes wisdom tells you that eating foods that are high in carbohydrate will exacerbate diabetes altogether. They will increase your blood glucose, they will increase your insulin requirements, and they will increase your oral medication requirements. If this was true, then Dr. Kempner's rice fruit diet should have resulted in a metabolic disaster for his patients. But why didn't that happen? Well, it didn't happen for one simple reason. Because carbohydrates are not the enemy. Fruits are not the enemy. They never have been, they never will be. Let's face it, practically everywhere you look on the internet for information about diabetes nutrition, you'll see the same message. It says, don't eat fruit. And the reason for this is simple. They say, fruit equals sugar. Sugar's bad for you, therefore fruit is also bad for you. Most of the people in this anti-fruit world will tell you that there's only really a couple of fruits that you can eat. And most of them are berries because they're high in antioxidants and they're low glycemic. Then you have people like us and others in the plant-based community who tell you the exact opposite. We tell you that eating fruit is good for you, especially if you're living with diabetes. How can this possibly be true? How can there be two completely opposite sides saying the exact opposite message? In today's video, we're going to go into the actual science of fruit to give you an idea of exactly how beneficial it can be for your overall health living with diabetes. A recent study published in PLOS Medicine studied over 500,000 Chinese men and women between the ages of 30 and 79 over the course of 7 years in order to determine the effect of their diet on their overall health. Now, we love these types of studies because they're performed in large numbers of people over long periods of time. For those who were living with diabetes at the beginning of the study, those who ate fruit 3 times per week had a 17% reduced risk for all-cause mortality, which is death from any cause, as compared with their diabetic counterparts who were eating 0 pieces of fruit over the course of a week. They also found that diabetic individuals who ate fruit 3 times per week had a 13 to 28% reduced risk for macrovascular complications, including heart disease and stroke, as well as microvascular complications, including kidney disease, retinopathy, and neuropathy. Now, refined sugars found in packaged and processed foods increase your risk for chronic disease, such as heart disease, diabetes, cancer, obesity, and the metabolic syndrome. But sugars found in fruit, long-chain carbohydrates, and short-chain carbohydrates come prepackaged with behind-the-scenes players, otherwise known as Wave FM, water, antioxidants, vitamins, fiber, and minerals. And it's these behind-the-scenes nutrients that conduct a very complicated orchestra of biochemistry in your small intestine and in your large intestine that actually confer a number of health benefits. And these nutrients, in combination with the carbohydrate, fat, and protein that you get from the fruit, improve your overall health, reduce your risk for chronic disease, and improve your insulin sensitivity. Now, there's no question that both refined sugar as well as whole sugar will increase your blood glucose values. Nobody's going to refute that. The difference, though, is that refined sugars will spike your blood glucose faster and to a higher degree than whole sugars that come from fruits. Now, you may be asking yourself a simple question. How much fruit is too much? If you accept the premise that fruit is actually good for you, then the next question becomes, well, how many pieces per day are acceptable? Should we limit our fruit intake to just a few pieces of fruit per day, or is there actually an upper limit on the amount that you can eat? In 2001, researchers tested the effect of 20 fruits per day on blood lipids and colon function, and found that within the first 2 weeks, total cholesterol had dropped by about 40 milligrams per deciliter, and LDL cholesterol also dropped about 38 milligrams per deciliter. As early as the 1930s, Dr. Rabinowitz and his colleagues at the Montreal General Hospital discovered that diets high in fat have detrimental effects on insulin sensitivity and that diets low in fat improve insulin sensitivity. They performed what's called a randomized control trial in patients with type 2 diabetes, which is the gold standard in nutritional research, and found that a high carbohydrate diet significantly reduced insulin needs very quickly. Approximately 20 years later, in the 1950s, Dr. Walter Kempner from Duke University demonstrated that high-fat diets not only caused insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes, but that patients could begin reversing long-standing complications of diabetes, including diabetic retinopathy, in a matter of days, simply by eating a diet that was very high in fruit. Dr. Kempner invented what's called the rice fruit diet, in which his patients were allowed to eat white rice, fruit, fruit juice, and, believe it or not, added sugar. Four foods that present-day diabetes nutrition practically contends entirely. Now, the rice fruit diet was Dr. Kempner's attempt at creating a no-salt, no-cholesterol diet that's practically pure carbohydrates. And what he found was that by feeding his patients this diet, he could reverse four conditions. Number one, malignant hypertension, which was thought to be incurable at the time. Number two, heart disease. Number three, diabetic retinopathy. And number four, kidney disease. Now let's think about this for a second, because it doesn't fully make sense. Conventional diabetes wisdom tells you that eating foods that are high in carbohydrate will exacerbate diabetes altogether. They will increase your blood glucose, they will increase your insulin requirements, and they will increase your oral medication requirements. If this was true, then Dr. Kempner's rice fruit diet should have resulted in a metabolic disaster for his patients. But why didn't that happen? Well, it didn't happen for one simple reason. Because carbohydrates are not the enemy. Fruits are not the enemy. They never have been, they never will be. Diets that are high in carbohydrate, as long as they are low in fat, and that's the most important part, diets that are high in carbohydrate, as long as they are low in fat, lead to significant metabolic improvements, not only in controlling blood glucose and minimizing your need for insulin, but also in minimizing the complications of diabetes, as we stated earlier. Now, in 1979, Dr. James W. Anderson and Kylene Ward published another study in which they took patients living with type 2 diabetes who had been living with the condition for more than 20 years. What they did was they transferred them from a conventional diabetes diet into a diet that was low in fat and high in carbohydrate energy, but they made sure that they did not lose a single pound. What they were trying to determine was whether the diet itself was influencing their insulin sensitivity independent of any weight loss. In order to do this, they practically force-fed their patients, making sure that they were eating so much food that they could not lose a single pound. The results of the study were nothing short of remarkable. Insulin requirements plummeted by an average of 58% in the group that ate a low-fat diet, whereas insulin requirements did not change in those eating the conventional diabetes diet. 10 out of the 20 subjects were able to discontinue insulin altogether, and those who continued using insulin were able to reduce their dosages between 7 and 98%. The most surprising result was that more than 50% of subjects were able to discontinue insulin completely after only 16 days on a low-fat diet, having lived with type 2 diabetes for many years. Now, the next time somebody tells you not to eat fruit because you're living with diabetes because it's too high in sugar, tell them four things. Number one, carbohydrates are not the enemy. They never have been the enemy, and they never will be the enemy. Number two, according to the evidence-based research, people who eat the most fruit have the lowest risk for diabetes, and they have the best short-term and long-term health outcomes. Number three, according to the evidence-based research, once again, there is no upper limit on the amount of fruit that you can eat. And number four, if you want to improve your insulin sensitivity and significantly drop your risk for developing diabetes or drop your medication requirements living with diabetes, simply drop your fat intake and increase your carbohydrate intake and watch as the magic unfolds. Now, if you enjoyed watching this video, be sure to like this video, be sure to leave a comment below about your thoughts on fruit intake, and be sure to follow the Mastering Diabetes YouTube channel. Look forward to seeing you in the next video.